Hi there, I'm Claudia. Today we're going to look at the different types of cells found in a Jupyter Notebook. We're also going to look at how to use each type of cell, how to toggle between them, and how to avoid some common but troublesome pitfalls when you're first getting started using Jupyter Notebook. Jupyter Notebooks are a computational interface that was designed for the scientific process. Specifically, unlike other software development environments, in Jupyter Notebook, you can not only write and run code, but you can also insert, format, and display text, pictures, and video. In this video, we're going to go over five things. The first is where the idea for the Jupyter Notebook interface came from in the first place. The second thing we're going to look at are the three types of cells that we can use inside a Jupyter Notebook, when to use which type, and how to toggle between them. The third thing we're going to look at are some common pitfalls and gotchas that beginners tend to run into when switching between different cell types inside a Jupyter Notebook and using the notebook interface. The fourth topic in today's video is going to be keyboard shortcuts, specifically those needed to toggle between different cell types. And finally, we're going to see how to properly save and shut down a Jupyter Notebook. For more in-depth tutorials, be sure to subscribe to our channel below. And while you're at it, don't forget to hit that bell so you're the first to know the next time a new video comes out. All right, let's dive in. Let's talk about the different types of cells in a Jupyter Notebook. So far in these videos, we've seen how to write code in Jupyter Notebook cells. Specifically, we've been using code cells. Code cells are a type of cell in Jupyter Notebook where you can write and execute code. There are actually two other kinds of cell types in Jupyter Notebook. And in this video, we're going to go into each of them and see how to use them and how to toggle in between the three different types. In addition to code cells in Jupyter Notebook, the second most important type of cell is the markdown cell. Markdown is a way to insert formatted text, pictures, videos, and links into a Jupyter Notebook and to format them and display them accordingly. If you're interested in learning more about markdown, please feel free to check the full-length markdown tutorial that I've recorded, and you can find the link for it in the description below. Now, here's a good question. Why would you want to add text to Jupyter Notebooks? Isn't it enough that you can write code and run code and see the results of your code in your Jupyter Notebook? To answer this question, let's take a step back and look at the history of notebook type interfaces in programming and what they were used for historically. Notebook interfaces are actually quite old. They first appeared in the 1980s as part of certain Informatica software packages. Notebooks tend to be very useful to scientists, and the same is true for computational notebooks. If you've ever taken a lab class, for example, you might know that a lab notebook was very useful. So notebook interfaces, like the Jupyter Notebook, were introduced to serve as a sort of computational lab notebook for scientists doing research work. In a lab notebook, a scientist would record things like observational data, computations, results, as well as a lot of explanations, usually in the form of text detailing the results and what the results mean. Now, fast forward to the present, and lab notebooks are, of course, still very much used. In particular, data science, which is a science in and of itself, has a lot of use actually for these types of computational interfaces. Data scientists run experiments, they write code, which they then use to process the data that they collect, and their data modeling then yields some results. The experiment itself and the results that the data scientist gets from the data is usually not self-explanatory, as you might imagine. So a lot of explanatory text, pictures, perhaps video, and links to supporting research might be necessary for a third party to understand said experimental results. You're probably now starting to see where markdown cells come in handy. In addition to code cells, which are very useful for writing and running code to process the data collected in the course of an experiment or in the course of a data science process, markdown cells serve their own purpose. In a markdown cell, the data scientist can include explanatory information such as links, formatted text, pictures, and even video to further explain and support the results and put them in context. One important thing to remember is that in a Jupyter Notebook, the default cell type is a code cell. So when you first click into a cell, it is a safe assumption, a safe bet that that cell is going to be of type code. In order to write text or insert other media into a cell, you will need to change the type of the cell from code to markdown. So to sum that up, a code cell is a type of cell where you can write code and execute it, usually seeing the results immediately underneath if there is any result to be seen, while a markdown cell is a cell where things like text, pictures, or videos can be entered, formatted, and displayed. So if you want to include some markdown formatted text or media into your Jupyter Notebook, it's important to remember to first change the type of your cell before you can embed things like headers, paragraphs, pictures, and videos. Now let's get into a Jupyter Notebook and see the difference between a code cell and a markdown cell in real life. This first cell here, which contains the print function, "Hello there, I'm Claudia," is of type code. The way we know that it's of type code is that, first of all, the code inside it has syntax highlighting, so the word print is highlighted in green, while the input of the print function is in red. The second way we know that this is a code cell is that you see this prompt here in front with the word in and then a number between square brackets. This is here to indicate that what's in this cell is the input, and the number between brackets shows the order in which this operation was executed within the current notebook. The third way in which we know that this is a code cell is because of this very handy drop-down menu here, which says code. If we click on this menu, we see that we have a few different options here. There's type code, there's type markdown, which I'll show you guys how to use in just a second. And there are also two other ones. There's raw NBConvert, and then there's heading. Type heading, if I click on it, you'll see that Jupyter Notebook is giving me this useful little pop-up message, which is encouraging me to use markdown headings. It says here Jupyter no longer uses special heading cells, and instead that I should write my headings in markdown cells using hashtag or pound characters like this. If you want to learn more about how to write Markdown and the various types of headings that you can write using Markdown, then go ahead and check out my Markdown tutorial, which I've included as a link down below in the description. I'm gonna click OK here, and you can see that even though this is not a cell type that is in use, Jupyter nonetheless went ahead and changed my code cell into a Markdown cell and put a hashtag in front of my print function so as to make it into a header. I'm gonna go ahead and delete this. And this is an interesting segue. You can see that instead of the heading cell type, we now ended up with a markdown cell. What looks different in this cell compared to the previous version of the same cell? Well, first of all, it says markdown here in the drop-down menu. That's useful. Second of all, the prompt in front of the cell is no longer here. So we no longer have the word in with the square brackets like we have in this next cell here, right? So that's another second flag that we're no longer in a code cell. The third thing that we're noticing is that the syntax highlighting is no more. So in this cell, we now have, granted, the same words, print, parentheses, hello there, I'm Claudia, but there's no longer any more highlighting. The text isn't red in here, the input isn't red anymore, the word print is not green anymore, instead everything is just plain black. The other thing that you're going to notice is that if I try to run this cell, what I'm going to get is just exactly the same text that was in the cell before, just displayed in a prettified type of font. That's all there is. The print function is not executed. I'm not actually getting the output of the print function. Instead, all I'm getting is the text. Print, open parentheses, hello there, I'm Claudia, close parentheses, and that's it. So what happened here? Well, instead of executing the code that I had in the cell, Jupyter just went ahead and formatted said code because this was, again, a markdown type cell, as we can see here. Now, this brings me to an interesting point which I'd like to make, which I see beginners run into a lot when using Jupyter Notebook for the first time. There are two very important gotchas that I'd like to point out here about cell types. It's very, very easy to go into a Jupyter Notebook and go into a cell, start writing code, attempt to run it, only to discover that you're getting an error. Or worse than that, you might not even get an error. You might just get something that looks exactly like this, and it gets you to wonder, why isn't my code working? The first gotcha that I want to point out is exactly what we're seeing in this cell right here. I typed up what is very much valid Python code, which should run and produce an output, but instead, I'm not getting an output. I'm just getting the formatted code that I wrote. This is what happens when, as you're writing code in Jupyter Notebook, the cell type accidentally gets changed from code to markdown. As you can see here, if you write code in a markdown cell and attempt to run it, nothing happens. It might look like your code isn't working, when in fact it would be working just as well if the cell type were the correct one. So to fix this, all I have to do is go back here, select code as the cell type, And there we go, we're back in business. We're back to having valid Python code, which I can now run, and lo and behold, I get an output. The second gotcha that I'd like to point out here is the flip side of the first one. Specifically, that happens when you want to create the markdown cell, you want to write, for example, a header, but somehow it's not working. Instead, what you get is an angry looking error message. For example, let's say that I wanted to remove this print function here, and I just wanted to create a header that says, hello there, I'm Claudia. If I go ahead and run this now with a hashtag in front, what do I get? Nothing. It does not look like markdown at all. Instead, because I did not convert this cell to type markdown, and instead it is still very much type code, what I'm getting here is simply a comment line. There's a hashtag here, and then there's the input to my previous print function, the words, hello there, I'm Claudia. But it's not formatted in a pretty way like we saw before when we clicked on the heading cell type. It's not the same type of formatting. Why is that? Well, because this is not the right type of cell. This is a code cell when instead what we wanted is a markdown cell. So let's try that again. Let's go and convert this to markdown. And voila, now I have a heading here, which I can run and it gets nicely formatted in big bold letters. Another situation that you might find yourself in if a cell that contains markdown gets accidentally run as a code cell is the following. Let's insert a new cell here, and we see that it's of type code, and let's write the sentence forever and ever. What do we notice here? First of all, we should notice pretty quickly that something is up. This is not markdown. Even if we wanted it to be markdown and we wanted it to be plain text, this is not markdown. Why? Because we can already see syntax highlighting. The word for is highlighted, the word and is highlighted. And the reason why these are highlighted is because they are both Python keywords. So Jupyter Notebook is looking at this cell, which is a code cell, as we can see here and here, and it's parsing the inputs of the cell as valid Python code. So if I were to try and run the cell, what would I get? A big, nasty, scary error. Namely a syntax error, because what I wrote here is not valid Python syntax, even though it contains valid Python keywords. This is an error that I see beginners do a lot when they start writing Python code in Jupyter Notebook for the first time, because it's real easy to accidentally switch the cell type from markdown to code or vice versa and not get the expected result. So in order to get out of this and fix this, all we have to do is change the cell type to type markdown. There we go. Now it looks like plain text. If I run it, I just get the formatted text. In addition to the drop-down menu here, which we can use to toggle between cell types, between code cell and markdown cell, we can also use handy keyboard shortcuts. Specifically, the keyboard shortcut for switching from a code type cell to a markdown cell is hitting the M key on the keyboard, M, and the shortcut for converting from a markdown cell to a code cell is typing the letter Y, like that. Now we have a cell of type code. Finally, last but not least, there is one other cell type that I'd like to mention, which you can see here in this drop-down menu for cell types. The cell type raw NBConvert is not something that you will perhaps use very often. This is simply a cell type that allows you to write content that will then be formatted and rendered as HTML or as LaTeX by using the NBConvert command line utility. So raw NBConvert is not a cell type that you will use often, but I wanted to mention it so you folks are familiar with what it means. And if you accidentally switch to it, you know what it is. But typically, you will mostly be using code cells and markdown cells. We're going to briefly talk about how to save your Jupyter Notebook and also how to shut it down. Saving your Jupyter Notebook explicitly is not really required. You can see here, between parentheses, the word auto-saved. What this means is that the notebook is being auto-saved by default, so you don't need to manually save it. However, if you want to manually save it, and in the process also create a checkpoint for the notebook, you would just need to click this little floppy disk button here, or go to the File menu and click Save As. That's all. If you're a keyboard shortcut type of person, Command S or Control S is also going to save the notebook and create the checkpoint. Now, what do we do if we want to close the notebook? Closing a Jupyter notebook actually involves more than one step. It involves two steps, to be more precise. The first thing we can do is that we can close the web page itself where the notebook is, and that's it. The notebook is closed. However, this does not shut down the Jupyter server. The Jupyter server that we started when we first created this notebook is still running. After the first step of closing the notebook web page itself, we'll need to go to the terminal window or the command line window and shut down the Jupyter server. Let's do that. Now, in order to shut down the Jupyter server, we just need to type control and C at the same time. And Jupyter is going to ask us for confirmation. I'm going to type yes. Let's try that again. Control C, type yes to confirm, and shutdown is confirmed. The kernel is being shut down, and that's it. All right, that's it for today. If you like this video, go ahead and subscribe to our channel and hit that notification button while you're at it too, so you don't miss any of the new videos that are coming up soon. If you want even more in-depth tutorials on Python and the latest AI technologies, feel free to check our blog at edlitera.com/blog, and that link is also going to be included in the description. All right, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.